Revelation chapter 1, I want you to look at verse number 5. It says, and from Jesus Christ. Actually, back up to verse 4. It says, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and ruler over the kings of the earth, to him who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and made us and has made us kings and priests to his God and Father. To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Notice that phrase, has made us to be kings and priests. Now, some would get really upset with the writer of Revelations. We believe it's the Apostle Paul that wrote that, and call him sexist because he left women out of that equation. Some would get really upset about that, but you got to understand what he's talking about. He's talking about a spiritual positioning, a spiritual place in God that he's called us and he has already made it. You know, I don't know about you, but I went to Karen Crow. It's been a long time ago when I graduated from high school. I don't think Common Core has changed the system that much where something has been made or has made is still past tense today when it was back in 1970. Is that right? And so when the Word says God has made us, how many of you can realize if he has made us, and that's what the Bible says, that he has made us to be kings and priests before God. He has already done it. How many of you feel like a king or a priest or a queen or a princess? You feel that way. You actually literally feel like you are. Well, then you are definitely in the minority, because I raise my hand to ask you to raise your hand, but there are times in my life I do not feel like a king. I don't feel like I have control over much, over anything, much less over everything. And so, but the Word says it, so that must mean that there is something that I am, that for me, I have not gotten to that place yet. And if you're like me, we can honestly say, I that's what the Word says, but I ain't there yet. And so there must be something that can help me along the way. There must be something between where I am and where I'm going, and a pathway in order for me to get there. And so the Word gives us some instructions. And so for the next, two or three weeks, we're going to look at the pathways. We call this the how we, you and I, can reign in life in the situation and the circumstances that we have, how you and I can reign as a king in life. And so there are some things that we need to look at, that we need illumination and understanding with concerning that. Notice the book of Romans, in the book of Romans chapter 5, Paul gives us two of the factors that will help us to reign in life. And now, you know that whenever Paul gives us a list of stuff, and he's good at giving us lists. I like his list. He talks about the works of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit. These are all lists, but you got to know that those lists are not all inclusive. That usually there's other stuff that you could have added on there. And he's writing this, so you and I have the benefit of going back and looking at the Word and seeing all that's been written through the centuries. But Paul didn't. He was writing the Word. He was writing the Scriptures from his prison cell. He was writing the Scriptures from his night. And you know, I think he wasn't in the Philippines, but he more than likely only had one little candle on the side of his bedside table. And he was writing this. But notice what he says in verse number 17. He said, for if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more, much more. Now, that speaks to me. Much more. In other words, he's saying that death reigned through the sin of Adam. From the time that Adam sinned until Jesus, death reigned. Actually, until Moses, the death reigned. People had no avenue to get out from under the problems of death. At the advent of Moses, when he came along and God gave him the subscription or the prescription or the requirements of the law, so for once a year when the atonement was done, the sins of the people were covered, and God looked at them through the blood of the Lamb, through the blood of that atoning Lamb, and so death didn't reign in their lives if they were underneath that sacrificial blood of the Lamb. But then when Jesus came, death began to no longer have its reign in our life because we are under the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, under the blood of the Lamb of God, whose sacrifice was once and for all. But then he says, much more, those who receive something will reign in life over death, over sin, over the challenges of life. He's telling us there's two things here, and we're going to look at just one of them this morning. He says, let's go back to verse 17, who will receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. When we look at that word reign, we've had a whole lot of rain in South Louisiana. There's been a whole lot of rain in Minnesota, but it's not the same kind of rain. He said that we would reign, R-E-I-G-N. Now, when you look at that word reign, it really is the definition of what a king does over his throne, over his region, over the territory in which he is the overseer. And so that tells me that God intends for you and I to reign in our life, in our sphere of influence. Now, that doesn't mean that I can reign over Keith's life or over David's life. Now, I can still reign over Jeremy and Luke because there's my blood. No. But you got to realize that if an individual, let's just say Keith, comes to Living Glory Church and says, Pastor, I believe this is where God wants me to sit, to receive, to glean. This is where God wants me to hook up to the body of Christ. Would you be my pastor? What he's done then, I'll get the right English, maybe, is say, in the realm of the Spirit, I want you to speak into my life. I want you to help me along the way. I want you to pray for me. I want you to cover me with prayer. I want you to help me when I miss something, when I'm not seeing something. Could you help me? Could you help me see? Could you help me counsel? Could you help me along the path of life? And when there's a challenge in my life, would you be there to pray for me? Would you go to the throne room and get a message from God and bring it to me when I come to church? And all of those things are said, but he's not saying, Pastor, would you tell me which kind of car to buy? Pastor, would you tell me where I should work? Pastor, would you control my life? You see, that's not my response. I got a hard enough time running my own life. We're not trying to run somebody else's. And so what he's done is he's put himself under a place of authority and a covering, and it's important to be under that covering, a spiritual covering, because you got to know that I pray for you every single day. Just lift you up in some capacity. I may just say, Father, just bless them. And there'll be other times when the Lord just brings someone across my mind, and sometimes I'll call you, and sometimes I just say a different prayer. But you got to know that there is a spiritual covering over you And it's right that you be under that. But it's not intended for me to come and try to dictate how you live your life or control your life. That's what the Word of God is for. And so we realize then that there is a reigning. That word reign means to exercise kingly authority over something. It means to exercise control. It means to exercise the highest form of influence. So God intends for us to exercise influence and control and authority in our sphere, in our life. In the things that we are involved in the areas that we are living in, He wants us to exercise that. Notice He says the two things that will happen is that I have to receive something. Now, when I think of receiving, most of us would look at the phone book and say, receive means you're waiting around and something is coming to you. You're receiving it. I remember, you know, right now, well, because of the work employment and so forth, I write the checks, and I write the checks, so I don't have to wait for my check to come in. How many of you check your internet, check your website, check your internet? When's that company going to put the check in my bank? It's supposed to put it on the 5th, and it's not here. We are the 7th. It's not there yet. Where's my money? You're waiting to what? To receive it. Well, that word is a little bit different than that. That word means to have an active participation of involvement where it's not just waiting to receive it, but it's actively seeking out what it is to grab hold of it and carry it off and to do something with it. It's kind of like when you go shopping. You're going shopping and you go someplace and you grab something off the shelf, you put it in the basket, and you go to take it to the checkout. Why? Because you're fixing to carry it home. Don't look like the couple that went to Walmart just recently and they walked out with a 60-inch flat screen TV, put it on a cart, put it in the back of the pickup truck, and drove off. And they got cameras checking them, pictures, and they said, they just took it. They didn't even pay for the thing. That's not what this is intended to be. We shouldn't, you know, but you realize that God says, I've already paid for the grace. I've already paid for it. And so you don't have to pay for it again. You've got to look for it. You've got to find it. You've got to find it in the Word. You've got to find what God has in store for you by His grace. He says, the abundance of grace. And so I've got to be actively getting involved with it to find out where it is. You know, the Word says that He gives us. I've got to get a hold of it in order to take it away. But you know, this is by faith. I've got to know it's there. I've got to believe it's there before I can receive it. Does that make sense? If I don't know that something belongs to me, can I participate in it? Can I get the benefits from it? No. But I might even know something is there and something is mine, but if I don't actively do something to receive it, I still won't participate and have the benefits of it. That's what faith is all about, that I have to know something. I have to have revelation knowledge that God has a grace for me, has grace for me, so that I can receive, I can function in an area, in the areas that He's calling me to function, in essence, in this case, to be a king in my own life, to reign over my life. Now, He says this. He says that we might receive the abundance of grace. Now, most of us think grace has been God's unmerited favor, and that it is, and that it's enough to get us into heaven. And that it is. But you got to know, Peter says it, it's called manifold grace. That word abundant simply means there's more than enough to go around. There's more than enough to get you through. There's enough for you to have and still some left over. There is an excess amount of the grace of God that is available to you. The Word says in John chapter 1 that Jesus came and He was full of grace and truth. And then two verses later, and it says, and of Him we, and of His fullness, we have received. In other words, the things that he was full of, we're full of those things too. They're available to us, and it's his grace and his truth. There's an abundant supply. There's enough to go around. And so it is his favor active and working on the inside of us. It's kind of like the verse of scripture in 2 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 9. God's eyes are going to and fro. They're going here, there, and yonder. They're going from every corner looking for the heart of a person who's completely God's. And why does he want to do that? Why does he want to find those people? The word says, so that he can show himself strong on their behalf. I believe that we could paraphrase it this way, that he wants to put his grace upon them, his favor upon them, so that wherever they are in their challenges, they're going to have enough equipment to come through it. Whenever they've been knocked down, they're going to get up. Whenever they're challenged with something, God's strength, God's grace is going to be enough to get you through even that darkest and that most difficult situation. When we look at the life of Paul, we find out that the life of Paul was actually a real demonstration of faith. It was a demonstration of grace. It was a demonstration that God is more than enough. Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, he says, by the grace of God, I am what I am. I can do what I can do because of the grace of God. And we know that Paul, everywhere he went, every city he went in, people rose up against him. There were a group of people that accepted him and received him, and people were healed, and people got born again, and churches were started. But the old establishment, the older people, the people who were established in churches or in the synagogues would rise up against him, and they would try to run him out of town, and they would bring him out of the city and then stone him. Listen, when they were perfectionists at that. When they stoned you, you were stoned. Not stoned, but you was dead. And so they said that the people went back in, they surrounded him and they prayed, and he rose up. Well, I believe he came back to life. I believe he was gone. He was beaten with rods and so forth and so on. But then Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, he said, I prayed 3 times that this thorn of Satan, this thorn in the flesh, this messenger of Satan would depart from me. And he said, all I heard was, my grace is sufficient for you. And so you got to realize and understand that the attacks against Paul was Satan's ability against him. But grace was God's ability in him to carry him through. You got to realize that no matter how often Paul was knocked down, and how often he was run out of town, and how often he was ridiculed, and how often he had the difficulties, Paul fulfilled the plan of God for his life. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, some of it from prison, some of it from different places, but God was in Paul accomplishing his design, his plan. So Paul fulfilled the plan of God for his life. It was a demonstration of his grace. The word says that he gives greater grace. He resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. A few weeks ago, we looked at the balance between grace and faith, that there must be a balance between the two. And so we can't overemphasize grace without faith and overemphasize grace or faith without grace. But this morning, we're not going to spend a lot of time on the faith side, other than it takes faith to receive that grace that God has available to you. How many of you have ever, does anybody in here ever plant winter grass? Mr. George and Miss Rosalind, the only 2 people. Go figure. 1 time. Well, winter grass is this rye grass that you plant, I think it's rye grass, that you plant right over your other grass, and even when all the other grass is dead and all the other grass is not alive, it's just as green and pretty, and you plant it because, you know, you need to have some grass for your cattle. But most of the time around here in South Louisiana, the grass is pretty dry. is pretty brown, pretty lifeless, and for the most part, we pay no attention to it. It's just out there. But come springtime, and when we start getting a little warmth, we start seeing some of the little clover flowers, the little white flowers, the little blue flowers. I remember when we'd go to see Mandy play, there was a place just outside of Houston. There were the little bluebells that would fly. There were acres and acres and acres of little blue flowers. They're called bluebells. That's where Bluebell Ice Cream got its name, because that the home office is right around that area. Just beautiful. But you know, you could have driven by there all winter long, and it would never catch your attention. Why? Because it's just blah. You could drive around my pasture or anywhere else in South Louisiana in the wintertime, and it's just seemingly dead and lifeless. But all of a sudden, when you start seeing the little green and the little flowers, you start thinking, wow, spring's here. And it's what it does, it grabs your attention. Well, you see, some of us are just like that. Most of the time, our life has been just blah and bland and normal and plain and doesn't attract anybody's attention, the devil's or Christians or anybody's attention. But all of a sudden, God's grace sparks into your life, and suddenly life starts coming up, and suddenly interest starts coming up, and suddenly you start blooming, and suddenly you start producing stuff, and suddenly you start bearing fruit, and people start taking notice. There's something different about them. Something's different about them. I don't know what it is, but something's going on in their life. Something's there. Why? Because it's the grace of God. It makes you more attractive. It brings people's attention to you in a good way, because it's not attracted to you individually, but it's attracted to the grace and the anointing of God. I want to look at four people from the Old Testament, how God's grace was working in their life, and how it is a power of choice, because we are given choices every day. Deuteronomy chapter 30, verse 19, you're very familiar with the scripture. He said, "Today I lay before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore, choose life." And so we have the choice every day to choose life or death, blessing or cursing. And there's four individuals in the Old Testament, that I believe if we look at their life, we can see some of the choices that they had to make and the challenges that they had that they faced, and how God's grace brought them through, or God's grace was withdrawn from them. The first individual using that power of choice was a man by the name of Adam. He was created in God's image. He was given a wife and said, "This is your helpmate." And they lived in a perfect environment. There was no strife. We don't know how long it took before the children came along, but there was no crying. There was no poopy diapers to change. There was no animosity. There was no bank accounts. There was no lack. There was no sickness. There was no disease. It was a perfect environment. I got to thinking about this. I don't know how long it was that they lived in this environment. They said they communicated with God in the cool of the evening. God would come and visit with them. I don't know how long they lived in that perfect environment. It may have been weeks, it may have been months, and I haven't really studied out to see how long it was. But I know it wasn't just one day. And every day God put in them the power to choose. We call it a free will. It's the power of choice. But you know what? If you don't have two things to choose from, you don't have a choice. If all you have is one thing, then there's no choice. And so God endeavored to, you hate to say this, but he gave them a test. He was going to test their obedience. He's going to test their loyalty. He was going to test them. So he put a tree in the middle of the garden, or in the garden, called the knowledge of good and evil. And he put that tree there. And I don't know how often Eve walked by that tree, or Adam walked by that tree, because the word says he was given the responsibility to tend the garden and to guard the garden, to tend it and keep it, to tend it and guard it. And so he was intending to guard it from the enemy, the wrong one, from coming in. He was intended to hoe and keep it. There was some work involved. So I don't know how often they went by this tree. But God had spoken to Adam and said, of that tree you're not to eat, because when you do, you'll die. And so this was what God was giving them, a choice. I'm either going to choose life, or I'm going to choose death. I'm going to choose the blessing, or I'm going to choose the curse. Well, we know the end of we know what happened. He chose death, because he followed to eating that fruit, thinking, and Eve was deceived that she, and I believe the enemy was telling her that, you know, God didn't give you all the facts. He didn't tell you everything. What more could they have wanted? They didn't know evil, but now they did once they ate it. And so what we see is that God removed his grace from them and caused them to walk out of that place of perfection. And life has been an uphill struggle for all of us ever since. Now, we see that power of choice come into effect right there. You see, you've got to realize that each one of us has a power of choice. God puts things, I say God puts things, the devil puts things in front of us to test us. Am I going to be obedient to God, to his word, or am I going to yield to that temptation? And we could go on with that a little bit, but let's not. The second one I want to look at is the life of Noah. Just briefly, we're not going to look at a whole lot of it, but just the life of Noah. Think about this a little bit. Some of you have told me, there's nobody in my family that's born again. Nobody in my workplace is born again. Nobody in my neighborhood is born again. I'm the only one. Now, get a hold of Noah. There isn't a single person on planet Earth that's wanting to serve God. None of his neighbors, none of his extended family. We're not real sure about even his children. But because Noah was a righteous man, the word says in the New Testament that he was a preacher of righteousness. Now, from that perspective, a preacher would mean somebody that proclaimed the righteousness of God, that proclaimed it. I don't know if he actually went out and preached, or if he was such that his lifestyle was the preaching, and he was the letter, and he was living a righteous life, and he was living right, and no one else was. It was God's grace that commanded him and equipped him and empowered him. When no one else was living right, he chose to. And the word says that he found favor, or found grace, in the eyes of God. God's grace will empower you to follow God even when no one else wants to make that choice. And when the storms of life come, God's grace will have an ark of safety for you. Right now, we know that Jesus is our ark. Noah was instructed to build an ark of safety when the storm came and the floods came. But do you know that when the storms of life come, you have an ark? And that's Jesus. that you can run into. Now, you may not have anybody in your family that's born again, but you've got a church family. You may not have in a neighborhood that's born again, but you got a church neighborhood. You've got people that you can connect with, and it's up to you to make the choice to connect with them. Get involved in some of the things that we have available so that you don't feel like you're out there by yourself all alone and there's just no one out there, because the devil will always, I like the way one person said it, the first banana, the banana that gets away from the bunch is the first one to get peeled. And so you stick close to family. May not be natural family, but guess what? Because Noah was righteous before God, all of his family came into the ark. His wife, his children, his children, there's his sons and their wives. I'm getting there. Their sons and their wives, they came in. I don't know that their life was as good as Noah, but because of Noah, they had a place in the ark. I'm telling you, because of you, God is making a place for your family. God is making a place for your family to come in. He is setting them apart. That's what Paul says, that they are sanctified because of the believing spouse. He's going to set them apart in order to bring them in. Now, they're not automatically saved because of you, but God's going to do something special to get them saved so that they can come in. Amen. If we are to find grace in God's eyes, we have to live right according to the word, even when no one around us is. Now, that's not always easy, but His grace equips you to do that. The third person I want to look at just briefly is the person of Abram. Abram was living in his own country. Abram was 75 years old. He didn't have any children, but he had a lot of extended family. His father had brothers, and they had children. And Abram was living in this place, and Abram was just an average guy. He was a nomad. He had his herds, and he would go from place to place grazing his sheep and so forth. And Abram was spoken to by God, and he said, "Get up." Chapter 12 and verse 1, he said, "Get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house, to a land I will show you." And he said, "I will bless you, and those who bless you I will bless, those who curse you I will curse." And then in chapter 17, he says, "I will make a great nation of you, and kings shall come out of you." And then he says, "You'll change your name from Abram to Abraham." And so God's grace, Abram found grace in the sight of God because he was willing to leave the old life. He was willing to leave where he was, where he was comfortable, where things were good. He was willing to leave that place to a place that God would show him. And he departed, and he went to that place, and he says, "I will make you exceedingly fruitful." So Abram, now let's look at Abram just a little bit and look at how that applies to us. You know, when you got born again, the Lord says that you've got to leave behind that old lifestyle. You got to leave behind those old ways of doing things. Sometimes you got to leave the old gods behind, the old idols behind. You've got to leave the old cronies behind. You got to leave all of those things behind. He says, "I'll bring you to a place that I'm giving you, to a land that's better." And sometimes, I don't know, there's no indication that Abram really liked the place that God had given him. There's no indication that he didn't like it, the place he was bringing him. But you know, there are some times in your life that God puts you in a place and you wonder, "Why am I here?" God puts you in a place. It might be a geographical location. It might be a spiritual location. It might be a soulical. It might be an employment location. And you might wonder, "Why am I here?" I believe that you're there because God wants to bless people through you. that you might find yourself in a place that you would say, I would much prefer not being right here, right now. I would much prefer living there, working here, being over there. But I'm telling you, if you will just obey God, if you just listen to God, if you just accept His grace for where you are at that moment in your life, God is going to bless people through you, and God's going to make your name great in that place. God's going to fulfill His promise to you as He fulfilled His promise to Abraham. When you leave behind the old life, leave behind all that old stuff, and you're willing to listen to God and follow Him, then He's willing to take you places that you'll never see, you'd never imagine that you'd ever see, because God's grace will take you there. It might be areas of in the natural, but it also might be areas in the realm of the Spirit. Because God can talk to you. And so don't just always wish to get out of where you are. God, what do you want to do with me right here? God, what do you want to empower me with right here? Thank you for your grace to see me through and help me to handle this circumstance and this situation. The third one, the fourth one that we're going to cover it real quick, is the life of Joseph. Joseph was a man. He was 17 years old. His older brothers, he had several older brothers and one younger one. His older brothers got together and they threw him in a pit. You think your older brothers were bad to you? My mother had several older brothers, and she said they gave her a whole lot of difficulty in her life. And she'd fuss and she'd scream. Then she got to the place where she'd just carry around a stick. And anytime the brothers would try to pick on her, she'd just take the stick to them. She realized how to take care of herself. Listen, there are some times you get abused, you get misused by the people who are closest to you. And you got to realize he was then sold in the slave. They were going to kill him. And one of the oldest brother, Reuben, said, let's not kill him. Let's make a profit off of him. And so they sold him into slavery. Listen, I know life has been tough, and sometimes there's been some difficulties in your life, but none of us have ever been into literal slavery. When he was brought into Egypt, I don't know, normally they didn't have a whole lot of clothes on the slaves. And he was brought in, and Potiphar saw him, and Potiphar bought him. But I like what the Word says in Genesis chapter 39, verse 2, and it says, And the Lord was with Joseph, and he was a prosperous man. Now, we look at somebody today, and they're wearing a nice suit or nice clothes. You'd say, oh, he must be prosperous. Either that or he's in foreign debt, one or the other. But God said about Joseph, I'm with him. He's prosperous. Even though he was a slave. Now, the Word says that he rose up in the house of Potiphar. Potiphar noticed that the hand of God was upon him, and everything he did succeeded. And so he rose up to the point where he was in charge of all of Potiphar's house. And then he was falsely accused. And then he was put into prison. And in prison, again, God's grace caused him to rise up to be in charge of the prison. And it wasn't long before Pharaoh found out. He interpreted some dreams of Pharaoh, and he puts him second in charge. Listen, what we can learn from Joseph is that sometimes, many times, most of us have had some hurts, some abuse, some neglect. Some things that have happened to us. But if you recognize that God's grace will carry you through, it will heal the hurts. It's still hard for me to imagine that when Joseph saw his brothers, he didn't throw them in jail. You treated me like that, I'm going to treat you like that. But see, Joseph saw the bigger picture. He said, what you meant for evil, God turned it for good. And so it might be that you've got to rely upon the grace in order to forgive. You got to rely upon the grace in order not to retaliate. You've got to rely upon the grace in order to let those past hurts go. But I'm telling you, God's grace will help you to do just that. Although Joseph was a slave, God's grace on him, God's grace in him, helped him to be considered a prosperous man. It empowered him to forgive the hatefulness and the betrayal of his brothers because he was able to see the bigger picture. God's grace was in him not to fall to the temptation of Potiphar's wife and turn his back on God. We would look at those four individuals, Abram, I'll get them right, and Joseph. And when we read the story, when we read their account, we see that each one of them had challenges in their life. Each one of them was attacked by the enemy. Each one of them had challenges to overcome. Each one of them had enormous difficulties in their life. But I don't believe we could say that any one of them did not fulfill God's plan for their life. And in that respect, they were a king. In that respect, they reigned over the circumstances. Listen, it might not happen today. It might not happen in a week. It might not happen in a year. The promises of God might not come about in your life in a week or a month, in a day, in a year. But I'm telling you, if you will allow God's grace to continue to work through you and continue to build you up and continue to bring you through and continue to help you in the areas, and you just continue to reach out and receive that grace by faith, then it doesn't matter how often you get knocked down, you'll get back up. No matter what kind of prison you find yourself in, God will find a way to get you out. No matter how abusive people have been to you, God will heal those abuses, and you will fulfill the plan of God for your life. And in that case, the book of Acts is still being written. And the book of Acts will say, when it's all said and done, Drake Menard reigned as a king because he fulfilled God's plan. David Damasio reigned as a king because he fulfilled God's plan. Debbie Fontenot reigned as a king. We'd call you a queen, but in God's eyes and the office, you fulfill God's plan. And you can put yourself in there. It doesn't matter where you are right now. It doesn't matter if you see yourself as incapable, because God's grace is more than enough. God's grace is sufficient. Like Noah, we're called into the ark of Jesus, and by the grace live right and beckon those around us to enter in also. In the storms of life, God's grace will protect you and help you to ride out those storms. Like Abram, God asks us to leave the old way of life behind, the old way of thinking, the old way of speaking, the old way of relating to those around us. His grace will guide you, empower you for the journey. Through the journey, be long and seemingly lonely. Though the promises seem to lay off though the promises seem to be a long way off, God will always lead you into a place of comfort. Like Joseph, you've been betrayed, hurt, abused. God's grace will heal the hurts and bring promotion that will when you make the right choices, may be forced to live where you would rather not be, grace will empower you to make the best of where you are and rise above the circumstances. And like Paul, we can say, His grace is sufficient. His grace is more than enough. His grace is all I need. And so I'll rejoice in my weakness. I'll rejoice in the place that I am. I'll rejoice in those areas, and I'll boast in them because I know that my God is able to bring me through. Amen. Father, we just thank You this morning for Your grace. We thank You this morning, Father, that as the people of Living Glory Church, we are here, Father, to receive an abundance of grace. Would you stand with me for a minute, please? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus. To forgive, you got to rely upon the grace in order not to retaliate. You've got to rely upon the grace in order to let those past hurts go. But I'm telling you, God's grace will help you to do just that. Although Joseph was a slave, God's grace on him, God's grace in him helped him to be considered a prosperous man. It empowered him to forgive the hatefulness and the betrayal of his brothers because he was able to see the bigger picture. God's grace was in him not to fall to the temptation of Potiphar's wife and turn his back on God. We would look at those four individuals, Paul, Noah, Abram, and Joseph. And when we read the story, when we read their account, we see that each one of them had challenges in their life. Each one of them was attacked by the enemy. Each one of them had challenges to overcome. Each one of them had enormous difficulties in their life. But I don't believe we could say that any one of them did not fulfill God's plan for their life. And in that respect, they were a king. In that respect, they reigned over the circumstances. Listen, it might not happen today. It might not happen in a week. It might not happen in a year. The promises of God might not come about in your life in a week or a month, in a day, in a year. But I'm telling you, if you will allow God's grace to continue to work through you and continue to build you up and continue to bring you through and continue to help you in the areas, and you just continue to reach out and receive that grace by faith, then it doesn't matter how often you get knocked down, you'll get back up. No matter what kind of prison you find yourself in, God will have found a way to get you out. No matter how abusive people have been to you, God will heal those abuses, and you will fulfill the plan of God for your life. And in that case, the book of Acts is still being written. And the book of Acts will say, when it's all said and done, Drake Menard reigned as a king because he fulfilled God's plan. David Damasio reigned as a king because he fulfilled God's plan. Debbie Fontenot reigned as a king. We'd call you a queen, but in God's eyes and the office, you fulfilled God's plan. And you can put yourself in there. It doesn't matter where you are right now. It doesn't matter if you see yourself as incapable, because God's grace is more than enough. God's grace is sufficient. Like Noah, we're called into the ark of Jesus and by the grace live right and beckon those around us to enter in also. In the storms of life, God's grace will protect you and help you to ride out those storms. Like Abram, God asks us to leave the old way of life behind, the old way of thinking, the old way of speaking, the old way of relating to those around us. His grace will guide you, empower you for the journey. Through the journey, be long and seemingly lonely. Though the promises seem to lay off though the promises seem to be a long way off, God will always lead you into a place of comfort. Like Joseph, you've been betrayed, hurt, abused. God's grace will heal the hurts and bring promotion that will, when you make the right choices, maybe forced to live where you would rather not be, grace will empower you to make the best of where you are and rise above the circumstances. And like Paul, we can say, His grace is sufficient. His grace is more than enough. His grace is all I need. And so I'll rejoice in my weakness. I'll rejoice in the place that I am. I'll rejoice in those areas. And I'll boast in them because I know that my God is able to bring me through. Amen. Father, we just thank you this morning for your grace. We thank you this morning, Father, that as the people of Living Glory Church, we are here, Father, to receive an abundance of grace. Would you stand with me for a minute, please? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord Jesus.